Well, good day, and welcome back to Mission Control. Joining us today is Bill Lane. He is the Commercial Crew Program Partner Manager for Blue Origin. And Bill took the time to come by and talk to us about what's going on with specifically Blue Origin, one of the partners in the Commercial Crew Program, and kind of update us on what's going on there. And Bill, appreciate you joining us here at the Public Affairs Console in the Station Flight Control Room.
Thank you, Kyle. It's a pleasure to be here.
Usually, before I get into exactly what all you're doing there with working directly with Blue Origin, but I like to start out with a little biographical stuff so everybody knows who you are. Tell a little bit about yourself, like how you got into NASA in the first place, how you came up, where you went to school, those types of things.
Okay, well, let's see, Kyle. I was born and raised in the Pittsburgh area, hail from a small town of Canonsburg. And as a kid growing up in the 70s, I was inspired by the Apollo program. Everything was about Saturn V for me, so going into aerospace engineering, that's what I studied at Penn State. It was a natural fit for me to come to NASA. That's pretty much what I've always wanted to do, and that was my dream. So here I am at JSC. Once I graduated from Penn State, came here working in mission operations. Eventually got through control propulsion instructor training and eventually became a flight controller in the booster world. So
So you trained crews first, and then you actually moved over to the flight control side of the house
that's
then.
right. So mission operations was a great background, great proving ground to really understand shuttle systems. And after the Columbia accident, I went over to the program office, worked orbiter project office as a mission evaluation room manager. So I started working on the engineering side and eventually became a vehicle manager. And here I am today in the Commercial Crew Program office.
So when you transitioned out of shuttle after the flights, or did you transition before the end of the program? How did you transition over?
I transitioned from the shuttle world to the Commercial Crew Program office just after the STS-132 mission. So it was the official last flight of Atlantis, which was a great experience working with the Atlantis team, the greatest team out there. So it was a pleasure to do that. After 130 STS-132, I went to help the Commercial Crew Program Office working with the FAA folks in Washington. And then I had the opportunity to work with Blue Origin folks. So it was just towards the end of the program when I transitioned to the Commercial Crew Program Office.
So the first last flight of
That's right. It was
Atlantis before.
as Ken Ham would put it, the first last flight
Right,
of
right. Ken Ham,
14.
the commander of STS-132. That's great. Well, now you transition over to kind of a new program where we've spent the whole week, and we will spend the whole week talking about the Commercial Crew Program. And of course, this is a great setting because we're in the International Space Station Flight Control Room, and of course, that's what the Commercial Crew Program is all about right now, is developing vehicles that could deliver crews to and from the International Space Station. So tell us what a partner manager, that role is for you as one of the, I guess, seven partner managers that are in the Space Act Agreement part of the program right now.
Okay, so that's a great lead-in with the work we have to do to establish a U.S.-based human spaceflight access to our International Space Station. As a partner manager, I lead a small team. It's called an insight team. Misty Snupkowski is my deputy manager. She hails from Kennedy Space Center. And my technical integration lead is Bill Hill Jr., who's also from the Kennedy Space Center. So the three of us lead the insight team that essentially works with each commercial partner. In this case, we work with Blue Origin. And we work with them on a daily and weekly basis to help them get through some of the technical requirements that we have for our human spaceflight capability. We monitor their progress towards milestones, and we make recommendations to the program on their milestone performance, as well as participate in monthly reviews with them and quarterly reviews with the program. So
yeah, that's what
we're kind of the
ask.
Front it's face of the of NASA. We are the front line, and we're involved with the commercial partners. In this case, with Blue Origin, we as often as we can get to the Seattle area to participate in activities at the plant location with the Blue Origin personnel. And one of the biggest things that we do is provide some of the NASA expertise in lessons learned. Flying this shuttle for over 30 years, we have a lot of experience with a lot of the systems
right.
that the commercial partners are maybe a little bit newer in working with some of these human-rated systems. So we provide a lot of lessons learned with through technical interchanges with these companies so that they can have some quality time with our experts that have been doing this, oftentimes some of the original designers.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you about the, you know, how you, you know, these companies are, some of them new and obviously a different world than the government side. So how do you integrate yourself with these companies and how do they receive that?
That's a great question. That's where some of the softer skills come in. As Covey would say, to be understood, one must first understand. So that's kind of, you have to understand where the companies are coming from, and you try to echo where the government's coming from. For example, a private company can oftentimes move a lot faster than the government when it comes time to making risk trades, making technical decisions, making design decisions. And when it comes time to, let's say, sharing data, it will often take time for the government to follow the proper processes to release data to some of these companies. So it's putting yourself in their shoes and trying to help them understand where we're coming from. So,
all right. Well, now you're working specifically with Blue Origin, and you said they're up in the Seattle area. And you also mentioned, you know, what people may not understand what milestones are. We know milestones are, but how does that all work in terms of their Space Act agreement with NASA? Because Space Act agreements, we work with those a lot, but we're kind of doing, it's a new way of doing business with the Commercial Crew Program. And of course, you're focused specifically with that company, right?
Right. So in the world of Space Act agreements, as you know, we do not levy requirements to their technical designs. What we do is we partner the entrance and exit criteria or the success criteria, as well as the milestone dates and the payment amounts. So as the InSight team, we will work with the partners to ensure that they're on track to make some of these milestones. For example, in the space vehicle, which we have a picture of here, we can see in a little while.
Yeah, they've got it up for you.
The space vehicle, the first milestone we had was the mission concept review. So we sat down and reviewed the entrance criteria, which was Blue Origin providing us with several documents to review, like the draft copy of the mission concept or the mission operations, CONOPS, and draft interface documentation. We would review those, sit down as a joint NASA and Blue Origin team to review the success criteria to ensure that, for example, one of the criteria is that the mission was feasible. So we sat down and said, based on your current designs, where you're at in this design cycle at the mission concept review, is it feasible? So we worked through that, and we eventually got to a point where we said, everyone's in agreement, it's a feasible mission, and we moved on and accepted the milestone. A little bit later, towards the end of CCDEV 2, we will have the space vehicle system requirements review. So it will be a very similar, or what we call the SRR. It will be a very similar review where Blue Origin provides us with the necessary documentation. We review it and sit down as a team and review the success criteria to make sure that we agree that the milestone has been met.
Can you talk about some of the specific milestones that have been met and kind of what's ahead for Blue Origin as we move forward?
So there are three efforts for Blue Origin. The first is space vehicle that we mentioned. The second is what's called their engine TCA. TCA is thrust chamber assembly. Blue Origin is developing their own first stage engine. And this thrust chamber assembly goes a long way in their development. So we are funding Milestones to provide testing of that engine, of that thrust chamber assembly. The first milestone that we completed was the test plan review, and that was that's already behind us. We agreed on that success criteria, so that one went well. The next one is the testing of that thrust chamber assembly. That will be done at the Stennis Space Center, and
uniquely qualified to do that type of testing.
Uniquely qualified to do that type of testing. Yes, right. They have much larger stands that can accommodate some of these larger engines, and once we start testing, then their final deliverable will be the a quick look test report to NASA. So that'll be the thrust chamber assembly work that we have to do. And the third effort is on what's called a pusher escape motor. This is a solid rocket motor that is intended to mount underneath a vehicle to use as an escape motor. And we will go through several rounds of testing. First, we have to deliver the test vehicle, and that is one of the milestones, one of the paid milestones. Then we will conduct a ground test of the solid rocket motor, and then we will perform a pad escape test where the motor is actually mounted to the pad escape test vehicle and launched. So those are some very exciting pusher escape milestones ahead of us.
We're visiting with Bill Lane. He's the partner manager for Blue Origin as the NASA liaison to that company through the Commercial Crew Program Office. You mentioned excitement. That was one of the questions that I had for you. There seems to be a lot of excitement, you know, if you're internal and maybe even external, but I see this, you know, going into meetings and stuff. Did you see that with all the companies? You see that on both sides of the fence, you know, that you're integrated with this particular company?
I do see it on both sides of the fence. Now that we're getting closer to some milestones where you're actually seeing hardware perform, a lot of folks are quite excited on both sides. So we can't wait. April and May are going to be very busy for us, so we're looking forward to it.
Yeah, exactly. I guess using the word fence may not be the right thing anymore, because when you use the word integration, there really is no fence any longer, because you actually are working so closely together, right?
Right, just different badges.
You know, the last thing that I was going to ask you is, and, you know, everybody gets this a lot, but, you know, how do you describe what you do to people outside, like your family and friends?
I would describe my job to family and friends. I call it a technical integration role, where my job is to seamlessly and effortlessly make sure that the companies are successful with what we've asked them to do, these Space Act agreements. And it's also a liaison role with working on the people skills part of it, to fully integrate teams so that we function as one team.
Well, that's great. I really appreciate you stopping by. This is a perfect setting to kind of tie the Commercial Crew Program with what's going on here in the Station Flight Control Room. Bill Lane, the partner manager for Blue Origin within the Commercial Crew Program Office. Bill, thanks again for stopping by.
Okay. Thanks, Cal. Appreciate it. Thank you.